Welcome back at another episode of our Father and Son Travels. In this episode, we will finish our visit in the beautiful city of Adelaide, visit the last family house, and we will start our adventure to Cairns. All honor give to those who nobly, striving nobly, fell that we might live. For the soldiers of Adelaide, I think Southern Australia. War memorial, it's also for the First World War and the Second World War.
Green War.
8 Australian divisions, different kinds of crosses. And there you have the wall, the memorial wall. So even though they're on the other side of the world, they technically were never ever invaded. They still were heavily involved in the war because of the British Empire, of course. And we have a lot to owe to them too. So this is the sacrifice of these South Australians. Yeah, it's all about First World War machine. That's I think in the Ottoman.
Persian.
Ottomans, Passchendaele, Belgium, Amiens, France, Hindenburg line. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. It's pretty impressive. State Library. Here we are at the old library of Adelaide with a Christmas tree.
Pretty cool.
Yeah. Pretty nice.
Yeah, nice, yeah.
You can leave your Christmas cards. Christmas man is going to read a story to us.
Yeah. A kid at gym went for a swim. A kid at gym pushed through the crowd. Here he is here. You know. Oh, here he is. I'll read a bit of the
nutcracker.
The nutcracker?
Huh.
The walnuts or cashew nuts?
Macadamia.
The macadamia, yeah.
So here we have the map of all the peoples. Jesus.
Do you want to see the console?
So those are all the people groups that used to live here before the Europeans came.
See if I can, yeah, I think they're the ones, yeah, that's what they call the room. And another thing I've got,
that's a pine nut.
Is it?
Christ. Bunya your pine nut.
Sea slug. Honey.
What kind of bush
cake? Cake, no.
No.
Wattle gum.
Hunting, yeah. Of course, the boomerang says shields.
When you use wooden shields, ward off.
Such inventful people, and
Yeah, the women do all this work, not the men. all this stuff. Men didn't even touch it.
It's all made from on tree bark, so the back side of tree bark, and they painted, use it as for painting.
And all the paints they use are all from the earth.
Yeah, well, nature colors, of course, the reddish color of the sand and ochre color, it's called. Very impressive what they could come up with. The art styles, as primitive as some of the Moor, they still were very artistic and very, they were developed so much that they could make these complex artworks, and that shows you that even though they were maybe living primitively, they were still able to think complex.
He's drinking water, fresh water from the riverbank, and he's using the sand as a filter to filter out any impurities.
Yeah, and here we have very impressive paintings. Very impressive. There's all kinds of a Tasmanian. This is Tasmanian marina shell necklace. It's all made from seashells. I mean, does that look like a people that have no culture or are uneducated? I mean, Europeans, of course, like in many places that Europeans used to colonize, they demonized the people and they told everybody else that they were not humans, that they were not equal to us. But if you look at these kinds of artworks, that shows you that those people, they had culture and they had creativity and complex way of thinking, just like everybody else. And that maybe they didn't have what Europeans have, doesn't mean they're not equal to us. Of course, today we learn that, but back then they were looked at and they were like, no, you're not like us. You were less than us. And unfortunately, history, as usual, went a dark turn. But at least it's good that it's now told in these kinds of museums. They get the voice and working towards reconciliation with people and learning to look at things from a different perspective. Because not always the white perspective or the European perspective is the perfect perspective. There are many perspectives in life, as you can see over here. Those are boomerangs from different areas, so Northern Territory, South Australia, and Western New South Wales. Those are coffins, apparently. Apparently they would bury their dead somehow in there, so it can return back to the earth. Here we have a whole bunch of shields. So those are their shields. Looks a little bit like a Templar. Because Aboriginals were not one people. They were, as you could see in the map, many different kinds of people. So it's like comparing Europe and then saying that Europe is all the same. It's not. Same with the Aboriginals, that didn't always get along, and that's why they were fighting with shields. So everywhere you go, in general in Australia, if it's a museum or something, websites, anything like that, they advise with that message. Because in many, I don't know if it's every one of them, but at least many of the cultures of Aboriginals and Torres Strait Islanders, it is disrespectful or it's not allowed to talk about people that have died, basically, to name their names or something like that. So, of course, museum is full of people that have deceased. So they will put out those warnings for those people so they can, well, avoid it, basically. Yeah, you will see that a lot. It's a very big cultural thing. And as far as I understood, you're not allowed to name a deceased person or, like, listen to their voice or something like that. I have to look it up, but it's an interesting cultural aspect because we, for example, in Europe, we would like to talk about our deceased relatives and commemorate them and talk about them and have anecdotes. And in their cultures, it's kind of the opposite. You don't talk about them. So these are from the New Guinea area, Milne Bay province. So Papua New Guinea, the right side of the island, because you have New Guinea Island, which is one side Indonesian, other side Papua New Guinea. Papua New Guinea used to be under kind of protectorate of Australia, administration at least. Now it's independent. So these are all items from Papua New Guinea. So of course they are closely linked, because as the story is that Australia was inhabited by people because of the Ice Age period, which lowered the sea level, and from Papua New Guinea people could then walk across the ocean and then enter Australia. So they are closely linked with their DNA also, but also culturally they have similarities. Also spears for fishing, shields. In the 1960s, of course it's a mix between the islands, Pacific Island regions, so it's a mix between Australian, Northern Australian and Island, Pacific Island.
Stones for fighting. Those are pretty painful.
Tony Tutson, there was a group of people travelled up to Arnhem Land at this time, and Tony Tutson and his wife Margaret accompanied Dr. Stuart Scoogle.
This is Vanuatu, also used to be on the Australian protectorate, as far as I know, or administration. It's already very different. This is New Caledonia. This was French. It's just still French, actually. Jade blade. Wow. So yeah, you can see the more you go up north, the more distinct the cultures get. Typical island cultures, this is Fiji, still used to be French. There's a typical Fijian clubs. Now they also portrayed in popular culture. A lot of war clubs for Fiji.
A slit drum. Alright. So you would probably hit the sides of that to have music.
Wow. This is also Papua New Guinea. But that's a different region of Papua New Guinea. Of course, Papua New Guinea is also very big. Actually, Papua New Guinea has one of the most languages in the world and the most cultures in the world. It's a very, very diverse place. It's a very unfortunate that we don't hear a lot about Papua New Guinea. It's still very well underdeveloped in the Western terminology. And it's slightly forgotten by the world, unfortunately, but it has so much to offer. Look at this.
That's just amazing. Just look at that. I mean, Jesus. All the time that goes into that. Jesus Christ. Wow. Huh. The amount of detail is just astounding.
I mean, imagine being the first, one of the first, well, explorers, white explorers, and coming here, and coming to this place, and seeing people walking around with these things, and this kind of stuff. You would probably be very scared.
It's amazing.
So you wouldn't say that, but it's a mask.
That is a mask. This is a mask. Looks a bit like the, I think it's like an ivory.
In the Ivory Coast, you have also a culture where, I think it was Ivory Coast, where they have something that looks like this, and they have a dancing and a sort of cultural event or something. And it's interesting how many of those, you know, primitive cultures kind of, they have similar traditions and similar things, and they, you know, in the end we're all the same, right? And that you can see that many times in what artworks show and what they end up with, and it has similar functions and ideas. But this is just amazing. It is apparently, yeah, apparently two people, you need two people to hold it up. Yeah,
this is also a mask. Wow. So they put the mask on
and they use the tube for making noises and sounds and stuff.
Yeah, you would definitely not think that this is a mask. Right here. Wow. That's a mask to me. Baning mask. Jesus. Hello. Hello. Hey. Yes.
And here we are at the animal exhibition of Australian animals, and of course a lot of extinct animals. So, Australia has one of the worst records for animal extinctions in the world. Unfortunately, that is true. So, that's all the reasons why they went. So, new animals like foxes and cats. Cats are a very big problem because they kill a lot of native birds and mouse and rodents, marsupials. So,
your average house cat in, well, Europe or America is, you know, considered a pet,
and they're actually very, very dangerous for the animals here.
Pollution, fires, rabbits, also a big problem, rabbits.
Wombat. So of course we hope to see a couple of those in the wild, not only dead like this.
A lot of nice birdies.
What did you think of the library and the museum?
Very informative, very informative.
Yeah, right?
And I never realized that, that there were so many animals that are already extinct.
Yeah, that's the sad part of the story, yeah.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah, in a sad way.
Yeah, definitely nice library, very big museum. It's free, so that's nice. And it's open every day. I think that's even day one day more than in the Netherlands. So yeah, that's for once the opening times are very relaxed. For once. So now we're just gonna slowly make our way back.
Hmm.
So yeah, after touring the museums, library, center of Adelaide, we're just back again at Glenagall Beach. We're taking it easy today. And yeah, we're gonna have a look at this little old tram turned into a cafe. So maybe Dad remembers this version. Unfortunately, it's Sunday and it's closed, but this used to be the tram that that went to the beach. And that's the one that my dad used to have back in the day. So yeah, the ones that we have now are from 2006 or something, I read. So it's quite recently changed. It's yeah, it's sad. They should have kept something like this and just... Yeah, they could just upgrade them somehow, but yeah. We know how it goes, money, money. Well, we have a midnight stroll the last evening in Adelaide. Probably the last evening you will have here in maybe forever.
In calmness.
Well, also that, but last evening in Adelaide.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe, well, maybe we come back in 20 years.
Well, who knows? Probably we'll change here well, guys.
Yeah, yeah, just tie you at the back of the car and then just drive like that, something like that.
Well, I'm still used to being on top of the car.
Yeah. It's quite windy today. Of course, we're at the coast, but yeah. 2 days ago, it's not like that. It's, yeah, chilly. Anyway, we can have a look at the Ferris wheel with the lights. Time to, well, prepare for tomorrow and pack our stuff and whatever. And then we're gonna get the van, the relocation van. Good morning from Adelaide for the last time. So yeah, yesterday we finished off our little walk and we hit the sack, as we say. Because today I'm picking up the relocation van, which is a system. Basically, you have to bring a car, or in this case a van, from one place to another place for a very small budget. So yes, you have a time limit. In our case, for example, we have 7 days to drive from Adelaide to Cairns, which is in the north. It's basically driving across the entire continent, which roughly translates to driving 4.5 hours, 5 hours a day, sort of. But the total cost of this van would be, I think it was, well, 75 euros. And then you had like 100 euros for a deposit or something like that, or whatever. So basically nothing. Which is insane, of course, this kind of price. You can also take some add-ons like chairs or kitchen gear or whatever. It's an actual van where you can sleep in, with a kitchen and a shower. Well, I don't take a shower, no, just a kitchen and beds. So yeah, it's a steal, because normally you pay hundreds of euros for something like that. So this is gonna be the first time we're gonna try it out. So now I'm on my way to the tram, then the train, and then I'm just gonna pick it up. And the thing is, with this relocation van, there are two conditions. You cannot drive during the night at dark, and you cannot drive on dirt roads for more than a particular amount of meters. So to avoid that kind of situation, we don't want any surprises like the last time, we're just gonna go straight up north. So yeah, let's see how this is gonna be. So we got off the tram, now I have to go to the train for like 3 stops later, and then I have to walk a bit, and then I'm there, hopefully. here we are at Kilburn Station. From here it's just a walk to the Apollo home, relocation home or something. So it's not gonna be so far, I think. Well, this is it. Let's see what we get. I think one of those small ones, exactly like what my uncle and aunt had. That's it. Nice. Well, let's hit the road and let's go and get Dad now. And yeah, he's gonna be pretty surprised, I think, because this van, I think it's also a bit bigger than the one of my uncle and aunt. So that's great. So yeah, this is, by the way, the house that we had. It was very nice. Ah, good day.
Yeah.
Well, ready?
Ready?
Oh, that's open.
Is that open?
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, try again. Yeah. Have a look.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Pretty big, right?
Pretty big. And that's your
table.
Rotating table.
And there you have the fridge.
Microwave.
It's a microwave, I think, or it's an oven, I think. It's both. Okay, good. Yeah, so this is microwave. Oven or something. Here you have a stove.
Right, you have to make sure that everything's stowed away.
Yeah.
And tied down.
So we can cook here. And a sink. Water is all, everything is up to date. We have plates, we have mugs, we have cutlery.
Okay, we will watch
this. Yeah, cutlery. Everything, tables, bedding. Cupboards. Even a cutting board. And pillows. Also towels. We got towels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really? I was going to think about that.
Yeah. Amazing, right? Pretty. It's you can even stand in it. It's in the one, I think, in the one that Nick and Mark had, we couldn't barely stand in there.
Yeah.
So.
Right, get the fridge open. On North East Road, have a look at the old neighbourhood.
Well, Dad, where are we going now?
I think we're going towards Dernancourt. Dernancourt is a suburb in the outer side of LA City.
Yeah.
And we used to live there, a place called Dernancourt.
All right. And how long did you live there?
Not so long, yeah, 2 years, 2.5 years maybe.
Alright, well, we're almost there, so then we're gonna see the second place in Adelaide where they have lived. So it's gonna be very interesting. See you there. Well, we arrived at the house. This is it, Dernancourt house. Wow.
It's all gone now. See, we had to do that all the way.
Yeah.
It was still a bit of a high slope. We had to dig away as much as possible and bring it to that side of the fence.
Oh.
So level it out a bit.
Yeah, some good memories here.
Yeah, we were fishing down the river.
Yeah.
And we also, every Sunday, we would have to go to church.
Ah, okay.
And then after that, we come home and then we watch wrestling on TV.
Oh, right.
Wrestling on TV, and that was all made up bullshit.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
so this was
the second to last house. So the Everett Park one was the last one before you went to the Netherlands.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, this is the one. Who's the first one in Adelaide from Ivanhoe. Right, and then. This is where my older brother Peter was taking films back then. Mm-hmm. Back then you had a film called Super 8.
Mm-hmm.
It only lasted 3 minutes. No sound. So he was also always filming us, and he filmed us on this this patio here at the front.
Ah, okay.
On a Sunday, I think everybody's in a Sunday best.
Hmm.
Right.
First wild one.
So yeah, the population on Kangaroo Island was introduced to protect the population in Adelaide because they had a really bad chlamydia issue with the koalas.
First wild one.
It was a control population in case they lost all of the koalas on the mainland.
There's a brand new knockdown.
Yeah, obviously. Wow. This one's new too, yeah.
Yeah.
Because I remember that was there just one house in that corner.
Yeah.
What that is, that's still one house.
It is still one
house. Jesus. Yeah, it's just that they've got a small swimming pool in there, and basically the whole house has been built around the swimming pool.
Wow.
It's a beautiful house. Stunning.
That must be millions, millions.
Well, I mean, everything's still, for Australia, everything's still reasonably priced here, so...
This will be a giant mansion in the Netherlands for a couple of millions of euros.
Well, we're just gonna have a quick coffee on recommendations of the nice man called Paul, who is the owner of the house in front of the old house of my dad. And he accidentally came back from groceries and he saw us, and he also helped my uncle and aunt earlier this week. So he was like, wait a minute, two times a van with people that are looking at the house in front of me. That must be family. So yeah, he showed us around, he showed us the koala, and he told a little bit about the neighborhood, about the temperatures, about the flooding problems that there are at the moment, all kinds of stuff. But people are really, really nice here. It's really true Aussie spirits, very friendly, very open, very gentle, and yeah, you know, you just start talking to somebody like they're your mate, right? And then it's like, oh wait, by the way, this is my name is this and this. So it's, yeah, he recommended this Mercato. It's an Italian neighborhood apparently here, so we're gonna have a coffee, and yeah, that's it. This is an Italian supermarket in Adelaide. And they have everything here, so this neighborhood is apparently Italian. And you can just have everything you want. It's like they have every kind of panettone here. Ciabatta breads. Every version they have. Chocolate. You don't even have to go to Italy. You can find everything here. Oh yeah. Bialetti. Amazing coffee. Well, I got them cheaper. I bought them much cheaper in Italy. Those are pretty expensive. $43. I think I got mine for 10 or something. Biscotti, cookies, tarelli. Of course, coffee. You cannot have, you know, so many things here, so many things. It's amazing. And then they have the fresh food and this, they have the cheese. They have everything. Sardo, yeah. Fregola. The meat section, every kind of meat, and the bar here. I'm gonna take some stuff, don't know what yet. So we have pizzas, every kind of way, and pizza patato, sweets, cornetto. They have really everything. You can even eat here. It's a dining area. And you can have coffee here. And you can have pastries. Typical polenta. And crostata al limone. Cannoli. Any kind of delicious stuff here. It really feels like in Italy. It's a huge store. And that had a very lovely Danish.
A Danish in an Italian store.
Yeah.
I was frowned at. How could you? It's stupido.
Which is American coffee.
Well, I got two postcards. And I'm quickly gonna post them
in the post office over there. I still addressed them to Joey. So one from Glenagall and one from Adelaide. So yeah, he's gonna read them maybe one day. And we are off on our adventure to Cairns. And we didn't know it yet, but there will be a great challenge ahead of us. So stay tuned, because it's gonna be a bumpy ride. Anyway, I'm very happy that I could finally see my family history in real life, and I hope you enjoyed this little immigration story, and maybe you have your own immigration story, so please share it with us. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.